everybody ready? Have a seat. Our program is about to begin. I'm delighted to welcome this evening three scientists who work in plants and climate change at University of Massachusetts in Amherst. Laura Hancock is going to begin. She will be graduating from UMass this May with her master's in organismic and evolutionary biology. She's been studying population dynamics of garlic mustard. It's an invasive New England plant, and that's what she's going to be talking about today. She plans to actually go on and get her PhD, but she's going to be changing her research focus slightly because she's going to start looking at bat conservation. So that's quite a change. And she hopes to work in science communication or outreach after she graduates. And after Laura, we're going to hear from Julia Wheeler. Julia grew up in Canada. She attended Memorial University in Newfoundland for undergraduate and master's degrees. And she worked on plant community responses to climate change in the mountains and tundra of the Canadian Arctic. She received her PhD from the University of Basel in Switzerland, and she worked on plant community responses to warming and snowmelt change in the Swiss Alps. She's currently a postdoctoral researcher at UMass, and her talk's going to be about forests in the Northeast and climate change, with a specific focus on the red maple. And then Jen Albertine is going to wrap things up. She is a visiting faculty at Mount Holyoke, where she teaches classes on human health and climate change, food security, and environmental science. She previously held postdoctoral positions at Harvard and at UMass Amherst, studying landscape-level responses to climate change of the allergenic plant ragweed. Her research has investigated the impacts of air pollutants, ozone, and carbon dioxide on pollen production in grasses and the interactive effects of heat and air pollution on crop productivity. She received a PhD in plant and soil science and a BS in environmental science, both from UMass, and she lives in Amherst with her two children. So without further ado, let's get started.
Hi everyone, so like Maggie said, I'm Laura Hancock. I am a third year graduate student at UMass Amherst. And before I started talking about my current research, my master's research, I was just going to tell you a little bit about the stuff that I used to do because I'm also really passionate about it. And I think it's really interesting, and I hope you guys are interested too. So I've worked with a variety of organisms, plants, insects, animals. And so one of my favorites is the top left. It's the purple flower plant. It's a species of plant that only grows in three very particular places along a mountain in Northern California. And so not much is known about this species, but I thought it was really interesting how we're trying to figure out why it has such a restricted range. I've worked with aphids, which I didn't particularly like working with. They're very small and gross, and they smell really bad if they're not preserved right. And I had to like separate them into species, so I was like really up close to them, and it just smelled horrible. So it's probably the least favorite thing I've ever done in research. But then my favorite species that I ever worked with, and why I want to continue working with it for my PhD, are bats. So I worked with an endangered species of bat out in Arizona and New Mexico a few years ago. And I really love them. I think bats are really cool, and people don't know a lot about them. And a lot of people who do know the little bit they do about them, I don't think they realize how important they are for ecosystems. But for this particular species, what really enthralled me was that it's normally they look like this. They're kind of a grayish-brown color. But when I would catch them and I would tag them to see where they were going at night and where they would be roosting, they would be really bright yellow, like in the picture on the right. And it was because they'd be covered in pollen, because this particular species drinks nectar from plants and eats fruit. And so it would just get covered in this pollen from these plants. So I just thought it was so cool. It was one of the coolest things I'd ever seen. And it still to this day is just the best thing ever. But to continue on to my actual talk and the topic of my talk, so I study invasive plants. But very broadly, my research deals with preserving the iconic New England landscapes. So when I think about New England, and I'm sure when many of you think about New England, some of the first things that pop into my mind are this picture. So it's fall foliage, forests, maple trees, which you'll hear about from Juliet later on, maple syrup. And so forests are really important to New England. And so my work is working to help preserve these forests. Okay, so first off, before I dive into my research, I wanted to define what an invasive species is. I found that a lot of people kind of know what it is or what this term means, but I think it's important to just define it at the beginning. So does anyone have an idea of what invasive species is? Yeah.
Just kind of goes wild and takes over the area where, and kind of pushes out native species.
Yeah, that's part of it. Does anyone else want to add to that? Yeah.
Does it have to do with a plant that's not native to the area?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, so you kind of hit on the two main points. Before I move on, these are signs that you'll often see along lakes, in parks, national parks, even just along roads. And they all have to do with invasive species. So they're really all trying to promote awareness of invasive species and why we should care about them. So with this one, it's like brushing your shoes off, because if you're walking through an area that has invasive plants, you could easily get seeds stuck to your shoes. And then if you walk somewhere else that doesn't have this invasive plant, you could then be transmitting the species somewhere else. There's a lot of invasive fish and invasive marine life. And so it's making sure that you're aware when you're putting a boat into a lake and moving it to another lake, make sure you're not transferring these invasive species. And so both of you guys are totally correct. So what an invasive species is, to define that, I have to define what native species are and what exotic species are first. A native species is any species that lives in an area naturally, and it's historically been found in an area. So if, you know, for hundreds of years, we know that this species of tree has been here, it's growing naturally, we don't cultivate it or keep it growing, it's a native species. When humans intervene and bring a species somewhere, that means it's an exotic species. So it's not historically found in that location and it's not native there. But an exotic species doesn't mean that it's invasive. It just means that it hadn't been found there before. When an exotic species turns invasive is when an exotic species has some sort of negative impact in its new range. So if it was to, say, have negative human health impacts, so if it was a species that caused a lot of allergies for the people in its new area, it could be an invasive species. If it causes some sort of economic loss, so it maybe interacts with crops or farms in the area, or with my species, it can cause ecological problems. So it takes over, forces out native species, and causes a loss of biodiversity. So my species, in particular, I might have mentioned this earlier, is garlic mustard. So I'm assuming a lot of you guys have probably seen it, but you might have not actually known what it was. It has multiple life stages, and even though it only grows for 2 years, its entire life cycle takes place in a two-year period. So it goes from seed to seedling, which is what's seen in this picture, and these seedlings are probably about maybe an inch tall, so they're very, very small. And then within a couple of months, it grows into this rosette form. So this is kind of on the larger side of what it would look like, but it's that big and there's a person there for reference. And then it spends about a year in its rosette stage, and then in its second summer, it becomes an official adult. It sends up this big reproductive stalk. It flowers, as you can see the little white flowers in that picture, and then produces fruits, which I will be talking about later on. A lot of my research revolves around that. So you can see these like little thin lines, but those are the fruits of this particular plant. It obviously looks nothing like an apple or an orange, but those are still fruits, and the fruits contain seeds, which is why we care about them, because the seeds are how this plant is going to spread. And so one of the reasons that this species is particularly important to study is that it produces a lot of plants. So one adult can produce hundreds of seeds, which means it can produce hundreds of new plants. And it affects the native trees and forests of the area, like I mentioned before. So this species is of particular interest because it doesn't just outcompete native species by growing fast, which it does, or producing a lot of seeds, which it does, but it actually sends out chemicals into the soil, which can kill microorganisms in the soil, specifically fungi, that associate with native trees, such as maple trees, which you'll hear about later. And when these trees are seedlings, it's really important that these fungi are associated with the native tree seedlings. The fungi help these tree seedlings uptake more water nutrients so they grow bigger and stronger. And if garlic mustard, this tiny little plant, can affect that, that can, in the long term, affect our forests. Okay, so a little bit more about garlic mustard. Originally, garlic mustard is from Europe, Asia, and Northern Africa. It was originally found in North America in New York in the mid-1800s, so it's been around for a little while. It was originally actually brought over so that people could eat it. People originally brought it over so they could grow it in a garden and eat it. The name is garlic mustard, and it does in fact smell and taste like garlic. When I'm out in the field in the summer on really hot days, the sun almost like bakes the plants, and the whole field will smell like garlic. It's pretty nice. Although it's kind of bad too, because that means that there's a lot of garlic mustard around, which we don't want. And in the US, like I said before, garlic mustard can kill native plants by killing soil microorganisms. So it's really important that we understand how this plant is interacting with native species and how it's been changing over the 160 years that it's been here. And to lead into my specific research, what makes it even more interesting, because garlic mustard is fairly unique in a lot of its ecological and biological responses, is that it normally grows kind of in these meadowy habitats along forests. So it's not in a forest understory. It's just kind of growing along forests. And so that's where it grows in Europe, Asia, and Northern Africa. But in the past couple of decades in America, it's been found in fairly high densities in forest understories. So you can hike a mile into the woods and find garlic mustard. And that really hadn't been found before. And so it's really important because of its interactions with tree seedlings and other native species to understand what's happening here. Okay, so my research question is based on what I just said. I wanted to know if more plants grow along the edges of forests or in the forest understories. I wanted to see if plant traits are different when growing along plant forest edges than when in forest understories. Because just because the plants are there doesn't mean that they're acting the exact same way that plants growing along the forest would act. And three, has garlic mustard been changing over the past 15 years since its introduction into a New England forest? This is particularly important because with a lot of invasive species, and with a lot of research in general, long-term studies don't really happen. It's very hard logistically, financially, to keep these studies going. Because once you have data, you really want to publish it and get it out there. But without understanding how garlic mustard has been changing over the past 15, 20, 30 years, it's hard to predict how it's going to act in the coming years and how it would act, say, under climate change. Okay, so to answer my research questions, me along with a few other people, because this study has been going on for 15 years and I have not been a master's student for 15 years, thankfully. Along with other people in my lab, I started conducting research at a particular forest site in Peterson, Massachusetts, at the Harvard Forest, if any of you guys know where that is. And so we went out, we identified where garlic mustard was growing out here, both along the forest edge and in the forest understory. And I know I've been saying these terms a lot before, but this can kind of help give you a visualization of what I mean. But a forest edge is kind of like this. It's very meadowy. You can see trees off in the background, but garlic mustard is growing right here. It's not growing in trees. So you can see that there's a lot of light hitting the ground. There's a lot of grasses and a lot of other really small herbaceous plants. There's not much leaf litter. But then when you compare it to the forest understory, you can see that there's only a few patches of like bright sunlight compared to the entire forest edge. There's a lot of leaf litter. It can sometimes be a foot deep. And there's tons of trees. And so obviously that's going to affect what's happening with garlic mustard. So we identified sites where garlic mustard is growing, both of these habitat types. And then we measured it. So I'm not gonna go into the details, but we counted how many plants were there. We measured the traits that we were interested in. So height, number of fruits, et cetera. I'll talk about that a little bit in a second. And this happened periodically over the course of 15 years. So what did we find? I tried to keep graphs out of it because my graphs, at least as of now, are very confusing and boring. But the main findings that I have so far, and a lot of this is still preliminary data, I'm still in the process of actually looking at what's happened because I just now have all the data. But what I found was the rosettes, so kind of the teenage stage of garlic mustard. The edge habitat has more rosette plants than any other habitat type. So there are more plants in this habitat than in the forest understory, which we kind of suspected, but we just wanted to make sure. And over the 15-year study period, the number of rosettes is about the same. So by this I mean they're not declining. So we're seeing about the same amount of plants that we did in 2003 and in 2016. So there doesn't seem to be a decrease in the amount of plants. Because it could be that garlic mustard just comes in really strong and then declines over time. But with rosette numbers, we didn't see that at all. However, with the adult stage, so when it sends up that reproductive stalk and has flowers and fruits, we saw that no habitat consistently had more adult plants, which was a little interesting. I expected there to be more adult plants in the edge, partially because there's more rosette plants in the edge, but that's very interesting and we're still trying to figure out why. But over the 15 years, there are less adults in all habitats. So even though the rosette number is staying the same, the adults are declining, which we also don't totally know why. But that was a very interesting find. Okay, so plant traits. The plant traits that I'm going to present to you, I measured other stuff, but it's not as interesting, was the number of siliques per plant. So this was the number of fruits. And so these are the siliques, like I said, they're long, thin, green stalk things. They almost just look like little branches coming out, but they're not. And they develop where the flower is. And then plant height. So how tall an adult is, say from the ground, how tall up it goes. Some can be 2 inches high, and some could be almost as tall as I am. Yeah, they vary greatly. So does the number of siliques per plant. And so what I found for that was that for plant height, and just to explain why we care about it, because if I was looking at this as an outsider, I would almost be like, why would I care about how tall this plant is? What does that matter biologically? The reason we care is because the taller plant is the more competitive it could be against other plants. So if you're really tall and have a lot of leaves and have a lot of flowers, a lot of branches, that means you could be outshading other plants, which means you have you could be killing other plants around you, which means you have more resources. So the taller you are, that might mean that they're healthier and more able to compete with native species. And so what we found was plants in the forest are about half as tall as plants on the edge, which is interesting. Which might make sense because in the forest there's not a lot of sunlight coming in anyway, so it doesn't really matter if you're growing up tall to outshade other plants, but in the edge this matters because there's tons of direct sunlight. And the other interesting thing was that plants are getting shorter over time, and this was quite dramatic. I wouldn't say they're like half as tall as they were, but there is a very clear trend that they're getting shorter. And for the number of leeks, we care about this because the more fruits obviously means more seeds, so just like with apples and oranges, if a tree is producing a ton of oranges, that means that it would be producing more seeds because the seeds are in the fruit. And so we were using the number of fruits as a proxy for the number of seeds. And so we found that edge plants have more fruits than forest plants, which isn't really surprising, only because they tended to be bigger in the edge too. And plants are producing fewer fruits over time. So that was surprising because we saw the same number of rosette plants. So if they're producing fewer fruits, you would think they were producing fewer seeds, but we're seeing the same amount of early stage plants, so we don't know what's happening there either, although hopefully I'll figure that out by the time I graduate. And then overall, based on data I didn't show you and other data that I talked about, we can calculate if these populations are increasing or decreasing or stable over time. And so what we found is the forest edge populations are growing slightly, so they are expanding, and that the forest understory populations are declining quite dramatically based on my preliminary data. And so this is just my summary. Traits are different in each habitat. Traits are changing over time, which is important to know, like I said, so we can predict how the species is going to act and interact with native species. And then the edge plants are continuing to thrive and expand their population while the number of forest understory plants is decreasing. Yeah.
Question. When you do the research, you said these are plants that were brought over from Europe originally?
Yeah.
Do you like being in contact with people over there doing the same thing that you're doing to see if, did the plants die out over there or something? Or are you in communication with, you know, other countries that have these invasive plants? Or?
So I'm not specifically, but there are lots of other people who are. So my advisor She collaborates with people in Germany who have collected seeds from like populations all around the world, and they actually want to do studies looking at how garlic mustard brought over from every, you know, country that it's on and every state that it's in, and see how it how it acts compared to every other population. Mm-hmm. And so people are going to do these studies, but I didn't.
It just seems interesting that when you talked about the period of time, that it didn't really get bigger. So it's not as invasive as some of the other invasive plants that are around.
So that's kind of what's interesting about this plant too. So it's native to Europe. I don't know if they've declined or not in Europe. In its native range, garlic mustard doesn't have quite the same negative effects as it does here. It doesn't have the same effects on soil microorganisms that it does here, and it just doesn't act the same. And so something happened, and there are a couple of hypotheses about why it's acting like this now, but obviously something happened once it got to this new range in America that caused it to explode like this. And there are some people who think that overall the population of garlic mustard is declining over decades, not over years, but over decades once it's been in the area. My research doesn't quite support that. It obviously something is going on, but I don't have everything analyzed yet to be able to say what is going on. But yeah, even in certain areas where you are, even in Massachusetts, you can see distinctions between how many plants there are in the forest versus the edge, and if they're taller or shorter. It really depends on the region and a bunch of stuff goes into it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm a beekeeper, and I'm wondering if you look at pollination as part of your study at all, as far as, you know, more or greater or fewer number of plants.
Or fruits
due to the pollination by the bees, and of course the bee population is always changing too.
Yeah. So for garlic mustard, the number of fruits for garlic mustard based on pollination. So garlic mustard, as far as I understand, there are insects that will go to it. I actually noticed some and some bees that would go to it, but it generally self-pollinates, so it doesn't really need insects to pollinate. Yeah.
Hold on. Okay. I mean, I know honeybees tend to like a lot of the invasives.
Yep.
Because they give out a lot of, you know, nectar and things like that, but I'm not sure about, I'll have to look up the garlic mustard.
Yeah.
The garlic mustard doesn't have a lot of nectar now.
Yeah, the flowers are really small. Yeah. It doesn't, I was actually surprised one year when I was doing this study and collecting data how many insects and bees I saw on garlic mustard, because from what I'd known before going into the study, nothing really went to pollinate it because of that. Like, the flowers are small, they're not like brightly colored, there's not nectar, like, yeah, it was kind of interesting, but I did see a lot of insects going to it. Yeah.
I'm interested how it tastes. If you've tasted it?
I haven't.
Delicious. It's like a tangy garlic taste.
Yeah.
It's really young good. Spring leaves are very good in pesto.
It's good in pesto?
Yes. Yeah. So if I get the spring, dig it up, spot up.
Yeah.
By all means, dig it up.
Yeah. If you see any of those life stages, dig it up.
The leaves.
No. Not the fruit. No. And specifically for older plants.
Yeah, the larger.
Yeah.
The smaller they are, the earlier they are, the better they'll taste. So then they get big, they get a little more bitter.
Yeah.
The young, fresh leaves in the spring, those are the ones you want to eat.
The ones that are this time.
Yeah.
I like that size, probably.
Oh, okay.
But it's more than adults, right?
Yeah.
Oh, it's the young adult leaves.
Are you familiar with the purple plant that grows along the roadways?
It's purple loosestrife, I think, but I don't really know much about it.
It's really, it's really, it's very, very beautiful, but it's very, very, very
I talked to someone else who said the same thing. They were like, it just exploded this year, and they're like, it's so gorgeous, but we just need to get rid of it.
Japanese knotweed. Do you mean the Japanese knotweed, the real tall stuff?
No.
Yes,
I think that one.
Or bones, right? Spiky.
Well, I hate to intervene, but I think we should probably move on. So thank you.
Give that a moment to catch up. There we go.
All right, so hello everyone. Thank you so much for inviting us this evening. We're all really excited to be here. So my name's Julia, and today I'm going to be talking to you about climate change in northeastern forests. So specifically, I'm going to be focusing on red maple. So, as I said, my talk today, I'm going to focus on red maple. A lot of you may recognize this. This is a very iconic tree species in New England. It's the one that turns bright red in the fall, and so everybody probably knows it from the fall foliage. It's a very important species in New England because it's actually one of the most common tree species in New England. And it's common for a lot of reasons that I'm going to get into. It's common and it's ecologically important. And that's what I'm going to talk a little bit about this evening, about the life history of this species and how we might predict it's going to be altered under climate change. So, just to briefly introduce what I'm going to be talking about today, first I want to speak a little bit about the life history of red maple, just walk you through from seedling to adult tree. I'm going to talk a little bit about how climates are expected to change in the future in New England, how climate is already changing and how it's expected to change. I'm going to talk a little bit about how our lab, how our research group at UMass Amherst actually researches trees and climate change in New England. And finally, I'm going to discuss some of our work about how red maple in particular may respond to climate change. So, that's gone through to winter, so I suppose it's good to move on. Yeah. All right, so just to get started with red maple. So red maple, as I said, is one of the most common tree species in the forests of New England. And one of the reasons it's so common is because it's called what we call a habitat generalist. And what this means is that it's able to grow under a really wide range of environmental conditions. You might have red maple growing in your yard in sort of full sunlight, and you also get red maple grow really deep in the forest where it's almost full shade. So red maple can grow under a wide range of water availability conditions, so a lot of different soil conditions, and a lot of different light conditions. So when it can grow in almost any habitat, you usually get a lot of that species, and that's why we have so many red maple in New England. It's also a very ecologically important tree. Before I move on to that. Another reason why it's so common is because it can thrive in these sort of full sunlight habitats. It really started to take over as a result of land use change in New England. So as New England transitioned away from farming into non-farming based activities, you had all these old pasture lands. And red maple basically started taking over these open fields. So that's another reason why they're so common. So it's a very ecologically important species. A lot of animals rely on it. So the moose and our friend the deer here are really reliant on this species, particularly in the winter when they eat the buds and the bark. But in the spring and early spring, they're also very interested in the new leaves for forage. Rabbits also feed on the buds and the bark and the new leaf tissue in the spring. And the seeds are a good food source for chipmunks and squirrels. So you can see that these are really important species. They're very common. They grow in a wide range of habitats. And so a lot of animals depend on them. So now I just want to talk a little bit about red maple's life history. So how it produces seeds, basically. So red maple, you may notice, flowers in the spring before it puts its leaves out. And this is a little unusual for a maple. A lot of maples flower later in the season, but red maples flower in the very early spring. So in Massachusetts, it's around April, and they look like little red-brown flowers, and you can sort of see them up in the branches before the leaves come out, and it almost looks like little dead leaves. But these are actually the flowers. So the picture here are a close-up of the male flower is here on the left, and the female flower is on the right. So red maple are what we call a monoecious tree, which means that it has both male and female flowers on the same tree, but usually on different branches. They don't like getting too close together. So the pollen is produced in the male flowers here, and it fertilizes the female flowers. And the female flowers are the site of the fruit and seed formation then. And usually this occurs over the course of the spring, and the seeds begin to mature over time. And the seeds are usually mature around June in Massachusetts. So the picture on the left here shows these mature seeds on red maples. On red maples, these seeds are called samaras. So they're these little winged seed pairs. There's two seeds there, each with their own little wing. So once the seeds are mature, so sort of around June, so late in the spring, early summer, they start dropping off the trees where they're dispersed by wind. And they have a very particular dispersal pattern here. I'm sure people have seen them before. The maple helicopter, people call it. I've also heard it called the maple whirligig. I like that one. So the maple seeds whirligig off the trees, and usually they don't fall too far. Usually they fall between 5 to 15 feet away from the parent tree. But if they catch good wind, these can go anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 feet away from the parents. So they're wind dispersed, so the new seeds spread out into the environment in around June when they're mature. And red maple are different from a lot of other maple species in that their seeds don't have any germination requirements. If you have any gardeners here this evening, a lot of you know that certain seeds have to be treated in a certain way before they can grow. They need to overwinter, for example, before they can start growing in the spring. Red maple's not like that. Red maple is ready to go as soon as it falls off the tree. So the seeds are released in June, and they basically land in the soil, and they're ready to germinate within a couple of days. So this is what we see, is that the seed germinates right on the surface. Within a couple of days, it puts out its first true leaf. So these small leaves here are called the cotyledons. They're more like the little proto-leaves, and these are the first true leaves here. So they can start photosynthesizing within a couple of days of germinating. And then over the course of their first growing season, they can grow remarkably quickly. They can grow between 1 and 2 feet in their first year, and then a foot every year after that. Red maple are very fast growing trees. Now, red maple put out hundreds of thousands of seeds. One tree can put out hundreds of thousands of seeds, and it does this because when they're this little, they don't live very long necessarily. So they're very small, they're very delicate, they're very vulnerable to predation. They're vulnerable to the little squirrel coming along and picking up the seeds. They're vulnerable to the rabbit coming along and just eating the little seedling. They're vulnerable to getting outshaded by other plants or getting buried by leaf litter. So they're very small and they don't survive very well. So
they're also vulnerable to lawn mowing.
To the lawnmower, precisely so. Yeah, red maple love your lawn, they surely do. So these guys, basically the adult trees put out hundreds of thousands of seeds every year. And in some years they can put out millions of seeds, specifically because the survival rate when they're seedlings is so low.
Do you know why some years they have more? Like this past year for ours.
Oh,
like
yes.
Are you getting there? Because I know some years we have tons. This past year, we hardly had any.
That's a very good question. Red maple, a lot of maple trees do this. A lot of plants in general do it. It's called masting. So every couple of years, they'll have a really, really good seed crop. And it's not actually very well understood why trees mast. Sometimes it's a combination of nothing went wrong that year, so they produce a lot of seeds. This year in particular, the red maple seed crop was quite low, and the reason for it was because we had a couple of very cold days in April. If people remember this past April, there was a while where it was like 60 or 70 degrees, we had a few days like that, and then it went down to about 20 degrees for about 4 days. And the red maple had already started to flower at that point, and the flower structures are really vulnerable to frost. So that can be one thing that causes real big differences in the seed production year by year, is if the flowers get damaged by frost, then they can't produce seeds. Okay, so these young seedlings, as I said, they're very vulnerable. You have to put out hundreds of thousands of them to get one adult tree. So understanding how these young red maples are going to respond to climate change is important, because if we have a clearer understanding of what's happening at this young stage as climates change in New England, we'll have a better idea of what the long-term patterns for red maple are going to look like. And that's going to give us a better idea of what the makeup of the forest is going to be in the future. So this brings us to our research question, or one of the research questions that we ask with our lab. Tonight we're talking about how young red maple respond to climate warming in New England. So now I'm going to get into a little bit about climate change. So this map here, it's a three-part map. The map on the left shows the historical climate for New England. So that's in the past 100 years. And what this map shows is the number of days in the year where the temperature is above 90 degrees Fahrenheit. So you can see for the historical climate, we're in this range of between 5 and 10 days over 90 degrees Fahrenheit per year. The middle map shows the projected future climate, so the climate sort of over the next 100 years under a low emissions model. So that's assuming not a lot of greenhouse gases, so a low level of greenhouse gases are going to be emitted. What we're seeing is a shift in the number of days over 90 degrees Celsius to somewhere in the 12 to 25 range. And if you look at the map over here on the right, this shows the model projections under high emissions, so high greenhouse gas emissions. We're actually predicting that we'll see anywhere between 50 days per year over 90 degrees Celsius. So that sounds hot to us. That's also hot for trees. So it brings us around to some of the experiments that we've been working on. So we work on these young red maple responses to warming. So we know, or it's projected, that we're going to see warming in New England. By the end of the century, it's projected that average yearly temperatures are going to be about 9 or 10 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than they are now. So that's about 5 degrees Celsius. So what we do is we perform a lot of warming experiments where we warm the soil up by 9 or 10 degrees Fahrenheit to see what happens to our red maples, to then help us project how these species might respond under future climate. So this is a small experiment that we have set up at the Harvard Forest. If there's any gardeners in the audience, you may recognize what's lurking underneath there. That's a germination mat. So gardeners use these to start seedlings earlier in the spring, and all they do, it's just an electrical warming mat that brings up the temperature of the soil. So you can use them for gardening, you can use them for science. So we collected local red maple seeds that we then planted under normal soil conditions, so just soil sitting in a pot, versus under these warmer soil conditions, which are these pots which are sitting on these warming mats, which raise the soil temperature by 5 degrees Celsius. We also have a much bigger climate change experiment that I just want to touch on briefly. This is also at the Harvard Forest, which is in Petersham. So this is a large-scale climate change experiment that was established 10 years ago, so in 2016. This is the view from above, basically looking down. What this experiment is made up of is 24 of these forest plots. The forest plots are 3 by 3 meters, so about 10 feet square. The plots have different climate change treatments. So there's plots where we've done nothing with them. There's plots where the soil is being warmed by 5 degrees Celsius via these buried soil warming cables, so electrical cables basically. There's plots where fertilizer is being added, nitrogen fertilizer being added, because that is another factor of climate change, is increased nitrogen deposition from pollution and agricultural runoff. And then we've got plots that have soil warming and fertilizer addition. So this is a much bigger experiment where people are looking at whole forest responses, but we're really interested in just the little red maples. So this is a close-up of what it looks like. You can see in the last picture and in this picture, it's pretty clear what it looks like in the winter, that you've got soil, you've got snow falling all around it, but on these warmer plots, they come out of the snow a lot earlier. So under soil warming, these plots usually come out anywhere between 2 and 3 weeks earlier in the spring. So that actually is interesting for trees because it gives them an earlier start on the growing season, particularly for these little seedlings. So I just want to present one data slide from our experiments of the past few years. Yep. So what this one shows, this is a figure here that shows red maple seedling growth. So the first panel shows stem height, so how tall the seedlings get. The second shows number of leaves they have, and the third panel shows the size of the leaves, so the leaf area. On the bottom, so across the bottom here, it's just the number of days into the growing season, so from when they were planted to basically the end of the growing season. Now the red points on the figures show the red maple seedlings that have been growing in the warmer soil, and the blue points show the seedlings that are growing in sort of the normal environment soil, so the soil that we haven't changed the temperature. So what we see for both seedling height and number of leaves and leaf area, we see a pretty similar pattern where through the beginning of the summer, the seedlings are doing the same thing, but then you hit about late July or mid-August, and the seedlings which are growing in the normal soil just stop growing for the year. They set their buds for the winter and then they're done. But the seedlings which are growing in the warmer soil just keep going, and they just keep jetting on into September. So they get taller and taller, and they get bigger leaves, and they get more leaves than the seedlings that are growing in the normal soil. Hmm. So just have a picture of what that looks like. In the middle here, this picture shows the size of the leaves that are grown in the normal soil, and the picture shows the size of the leaves in the warmer soil. So you can see that there's a big difference in the size of the leaves. And the last picture here shows the root sizes. So when you dig the seedlings up at the end of the growing season, that top root comes from the normal soil, the bottom root comes from the warmer soil. So we see that these red maple seedlings, when you grow them in warmer soil, they grow a lot later in the season, and they grow a lot bigger than the ones that are in the cooler soil. So, in terms of the other work that we're doing in our lab, we're also looking at how red maple respond to other climate change factors, like increased nutrients in the soil, like I mentioned, and also invasive species, like Laura's discussed. So we're looking at really how all these different climate change factors, not just warming, interact to influence red maple. We also study how red maple actually interact with the soil microorganism community. But just for the key messages for tonight's talk, we see that red maple, which is a very common tree species in New England, may actually benefit from climate change, because we're seeing so much increased growth in its early vulnerable seedling stage. So that means you should hug a red maple today. Oh, yeah. All right. All right, any questions?
I read a book that said that the red maple was a keystone species that could support over 400 kinds of insects and therefore lots of birds.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of those really critical trees. And I was so afraid you were going to say that who's going to injure that?
No.
We need more of that.
Now, the thing is, this is the interesting thing, is that we're just talking about red maple here, right? And if the conclusions we draw are that red maple are going to respond positively to global warming, that's good for red maple. But it's maybe not great for other tree species. There's only so much room in the forest. And there's only so many resources in the soil for the plants. So if red maples start taking over because they get this performance boost when they're seedlings, that could be at the expense of other important species like oak. Oak, for instance, does not do quite, there's not a ton of evidence yet, but oak does not do as well under warming, so. Mm.
Mm-hmm. What about sugar maples?
Mm. Yes, sugar maple is the species that is sort of coming up next for us for research. Sugar maple do not do as well under warming. One of the main issues when we're talking about trees and climate change, it's not just sort of on the individual level. Today I was sort of talking about, okay, how do individual trees do when you warm it up? But when you talk about where they are on the map, basically, their distribution. So under climate change, we really see range expansions or range contractions as trees have to sort of move along in terms of their distribution to track what their temperature requirements are. If it's too hot over here, they'll move down where it's cooler on the map, or vice versa, like that. So one of the issues that we do see is that trees start tracking further north because it's getting too warm for them. So what you might see is like the disappearance almost of some tree species out of New England entirely because they have to track farther north to meet their temperature requirements. Now, sugar maple is one of the species that does not do as well under climate warming, and it's not entirely certain yet why. So there's a lot of work on being done right now on sugar maple responses to climate change, but they do seem to have a lot higher mortality in warmer temperatures. So some research is now interested in finding replacements for sugar maple, and red maple is one potential replacement, although it doesn't produce sap as high a quality, so.
And I know we're short on time, but so as climate warms and trees track north so that they can find cooler climates, are trees from southern warmer climates tracking north into New England?
Yes.
And so what do we, what kinds of trees might those be, and what might we see in 200 years?
Maybe palm trees. Ginger species are sort of trending to move up into this area.
Beech,
yeah. You have sort of more of the southern forests right. that are tending to move up. And the suggestion is that the oak and maple forest moves north and something from further south comes in to replace it. Although we do see like these sort of broad predictions, right, which maybe don't hold true at the individual species level. Like for instance, the red maple, they might do fine under warming, but the maple forest in general sort of tracks up a little bit.
Yeah. Or sugar maple.
Yeah. There's winners and losers in climate change. It's a good takeaway message. And red maple can be a winner, and other species might be losers. So,
thank you, Julia.
Found in these open grasslands. And then we're gonna bring humans into the picture. So we'll talk about allergies. So who here suffers from pollen allergies? Quite a few. So you're on track with the rest of the world. In the United States alone, about 40 million people are affected by allergies each year. This results in $4.5 billion annually in healthcare costs, and about 4 million days of lost productivity from work and school, from everyone all together, and the amount of days that they're missing. Worldwide is also a problem, and so about 10 to 30% of the worldwide population is affected by allergies, and this is about 300 million people with asthma are impacted by allergies more than the rest of us. Does anyone here have asthma on top of allergies? So you get it rough. And so this is expected to increase with climate change, both just the severity of the allergies and also the numbers of people affected, and we'll get into why. So what time of the year are your allergies the worst? How about people in the spring? So most of you are probably allergic to tree pollen and those kinds of things. How about the summer? So I'm in the summer, so that's mostly grasses and some weed species. And then how about the late summer or the fall? So you guys are all probably really allergic to ragweed, which is the number one most allergenic species in North America. So when we talk about allergies, we're mostly allergic to what we would call is wind-borne pollen. So it's pollen that's just blown by the wind to get from the male flowers to the female flowers. It's very light, it's easily wind-borne, and so that's why when it's flying through the air, we suck it into our nose and we have an allergic response. Insect pollinated pollen is much heavier and much stickier, so you can have an allergic response to that, but you really have to bend over and kind of snuff the pollen up your nose, right? It's not just gonna blow in like we have the wind-borne pollen. So pollen's very beautiful. I bet you didn't know that pollen looks like this. So we can actually, if pollen blows onto a slide, we can identify pollen from different tree species or grasses and whatnot. And so this is an electron scanning microscope, and so they've dyed it. They're not normally these colors, but you can see they're very beautiful. They're all shaped very differently. But we can also just see them under a normal microscope. And this is what they look like underneath a compound microscope that you might see in a laboratory in UMass. And so you can still see the morphology, even though it's not a fancy electron microscope. You can see the way it looks like.
Are they all that color?
Yeah, so they're a really yellowy color, especially when they've been smashed onto a slide. Not very pretty. The electron scanning microscope is much more pretty, huh? So, pollen has this protein coating around the outside of it. So we have different... We have the exine, which is this kind of bumpy thing that goes around the outside, and then you have this intine, which is this next layer, and then you have the cytoplasm inside, so pollen's basically just like a cell. And so all of these have this protein that we would call an allergen. It's important for its function because as it's blowing through the air and it lands on a female flower, it has to cross-communicate with the female flower to know that it's the correct flower that it landed on. And then it will germinate, and it makes a pollen tube that goes down into the female flower and gives the male cells, this is the male gametophyte, and it makes the seeds. However, when we inhale the pollen, our body treats these proteins that are very important for the signaling as foreign bodies, and that's why we have an allergic response. Mm-hmm. And so in terms of a mechanism of an allergy, it doesn't really happen the first time you come into contact with pollen. The antigen, or the pollen grain, we inhale it, and it comes into our system, and the little proteins absorb into our mucous membranes, and our body takes them up. And then we have these macrophages that come and try to eat it up, because it's a foreign body. We don't want foreign bodies. It makes us sick, right? Our body protects us against it. And so after the first time it's come into contact with it, it takes note on what that structure looks like. So each pollen, each protein has its own conformation. And so the memory T cell then remembers that, and it passes the information on to a B cell, which then produces IgE, which is basically our function of our immune system. And so now we have all these IgEs floating around in our body that attach to these mast cells. And so the next time that we're coming into contact with the allergen, that's when our body is like, hey, I know what this is, I don't want it in my body. And then we have the histamine reaction, which is our sneezing and our runny noses that we have. So you have to actually come into contact with pollen a couple times before you actually have an allergic response. And not everyone raises their hands in here today, right? And so not everyone has allergic responses to pollen, and they really don't know why. They're still trying to figure that out. So there's some lucky ones amongst us. I am not one of them. So for my research, I was interested in looking at these two species that grow in open meadows. They're two of the 11 most allergenic pollen species out there to humans. Both of these flower from mid to late summer, which is where my allergies are the worst, and so these are what I was interested in. So over on the left side, we have ragweed is a common name, and so this is actually the most allergenic plant in North America. The reason for that is it grows just about everywhere. In the Midwest, it's a huge weed that is a problem for agricultural crops, because it grows so big, it shades out the agricultural crops. And it produces a very large amount of pollen, as Laura and I can attest to. And then over here on this side, we have a grass species. It's called Phlium pratense. The common name is Timothy grass. It's actually a forage grass, and so farmers plant it in our fields for hay. So they plant it, and if you have guinea pigs or rabbits, this is what you feed them when you buy it from the store. But it's the second most, so grass is second to ragweed, and this is the second most allergenic grass. I chose it because it was very easy to work with based on the flower, the way the flower is flower.
so we can look up closer. So this is the male flower of the ragweed. So these are actually spikes that it forms. You can see there's many male flowers on one spike of a ragweed. And then if you look closer into these male flowers, you can see there's probably 50 to 60 pockets that burst out hundreds and hundreds of pollen grains. And that's what the pollen looks like close up. It's very spiky, which is part of the reason why it's probably so allergenic, is it kind of gets in our body and the spikes attach and releases the protein really well. This is Timothy grass or phleum. And so ragweed has separate male and female flowers in the same plant. On Timothy grass, the male and female flowers are in the same spike here. You can see here the male flowers have burst out, and these are the little filaments that release the pollen, and that's what grass pollen looks like. So as you can see, so this is one plant so each one grass plant only produces one flower. Each one of our ragweed plants can produce 300 to 400 to 500 flowers with all these little spikes on each of these spikelets. So it produces a lot more pollen per plant, which is why it's so horrible. So I wanted to know how climate change is going to affect how much pollen is produced by these plants. And so basically we're increasing the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere through the burning of our fossil fuels. The top three greenhouse gases that are released that are irrelevant are carbon dioxide, the second is methane, and the third is ozone. So ozone itself is not released directly from our tailpipe. It's a combination of other gases that we release, like nitrogen dioxide, that then undergo a reaction with sunlight to form ozone. Carbon dioxide, the number one most important greenhouse gas, is rising much faster than was originally predicted. Right now it's at about 403 parts per million, actually, not 400. And by 2100, it's expected, just less than 100 years from now, it's expected to be close to 1,000 parts per million. And so we chose 800 parts per million for one of our studies and 600 and 800 for another one of our studies, just because it's kind of a medium and future prediction. Ozone. Normally you can go outside in the summertime and it's anywhere from 30 to 40 parts per billion. It's expected that the background levels can rise up to 700 parts per billion. And so these are just background levels on a clean air day. Wow. So I don't know if you've heard, you know, a red alert day when the air is really bad. And so on those days, often the ozone's getting up to 120, 140 parts per billion. And so we're talking about the nice clean air days, we're still gonna see these levels of ozone in the future. And that's because of the amount of pollution that we're kicking out into the atmosphere. And so all of these gases result in warming temperatures due to the greenhouse effect. So it's kind of like a sponge. And so as the sun comes in, as it goes to leave, it gets absorbed by these extra gases and it warms our atmosphere. And so we can actually go back in time and look at how carbon dioxide concentrations in our atmosphere have changed. So this is going back since 1000 AD. So you can see for quite a while in the past, it was relatively stable on this graph. And then right about here, we start to see a peak. What do you think happened here?
Industrial revolution.
Yes. Educated women. So you can dramatically see that when we start burning fossil fuels in our steam-powered engines, we start to see this huge increase in CO2. And then over here, this is from an observatory tower in Hawaii. So this is just from 1960 to 2006. So we see these up and downs happening. Does anyone know what that is? The little squiggles that we see?
Seasons.
Yeah, so in the winter time in the Northern Hemisphere, we don't have a lot of carbon dioxide being taken up by our trees because they don't have leaves on them, right? They're going through their winter period. And in the summertime, when they leaf out and they start taking up all the carbon dioxide, we see little dips. This is actually the earth breathing, as we like to call it. So it's really beautiful.
But in Hawaii, there's not that amount of change. It's not like here where winter and summer are very different temperatures. So why are you seeing so much of a change when the seasons don't change that much?
So because the Northern Hemisphere has such a large amount of landmass compared to the rest of the Earth, we really affect what's going on all over the Earth. So the levels of CO2 are equal no matter where you are on Earth. And so the reason they have the observatory in Hawaii is because it's not near influence of cities and whatnot. It's a pretty stable environment. And so when it sees it going up and down and the fluctuations, it's coming from everywhere. It's not like a localized thing.
And does the bog affect that at all?
The what?
The bog, the volcanic
smog. So it wouldn't affect the CO2 levels very much. Not to an extent like the leafing in and leafing out of Northern Hemisphere does.
Volcanoes do affect CO2 a little bit.
They do, but not, I mean, it's...
Not at that big global level.
It's not to this extent. It's very minuscule.
And how can you measure it in 1,000 AD?
Oh, good question. So it's called paleoclimate data. And so there's several ways that we can do it. We can go into ice records. And so you can take an ice core. And in the ice core, there's little tiny bubbles that are trapped in the ice core. And so they can actually extract the air trapped in the gas bubble and see what the concentrations of gases are in that bubble. We can, the other thing is carbon has isotopes, so you have a heavier isotope and a lighter isotope, and over time that changes, and so you can actually carbon date things, and you can see how much of the heavier or the lighter CO2 is in the atmosphere. So there's many ways that we can go back and look and see what the gas concentrations were, what temperature was in the past, lots of things in the past.
And one more question.
Yeah.
So is there a variation depending on where on you're taking samples?
Not with carbon dioxide. This is actually lots of different cores from Antarctica, from Greenland, from the top of Mount Kilimanjaro that have been put together to kind of create this data. And so if you want to go back farther in time, we can go back 300,000 years from these ice cores, and we can see that in the last 300,000 years, we've never had CO2 levels as high as we have today in 2016. So it's pretty drastic how much CO2 we've pumped in the air compared to what's been there naturally over the past.
You know, I was just gonna say,
like tomorrow.
Good. For my research, I wanted to look at carbon dioxide and ozone because they actually have opposite effects on plants. So carbon dioxide is what we would call plant food. That's what the plant takes up and uses in photosynthesis to make carbohydrates or sugars that are passed on for growth. So we eat and we have fuel from also. Ozone has the opposite effect. Ozone is a very strong oxidant, and so it actually damages cells and has a negative effect on plant growth. So you kind of want to picture it as like a pinball bouncing around a pinball machine. And every time it hits something, it rips a little hole in a cell, and the cells become leaky and die. So I wanted to see how, if I put these two gases together, are we going to see a change? Is one going to outweigh the other, or are they going to equal each other out? What's going to happen? So before I get to my specific research, I just want to go over how climate change is already known to be affecting pollen, besides what I'm just looking at. So as I said, carbon dioxide stimulates plant growth. And we can see that carbon dioxide in the city, it can be higher because you have all the cars and everything that are polluting, and so you have higher levels of CO2 in a city than you would in a rural environment. Not by much, like maybe 10 parts per million, but there is a little bit of a gradient. And so someone looked at the number of pollen being produced by ragweed inside the urban environment and then going out to a more rural environment. And so inside the city, they saw a count of about 12,138 pollen grains per cubic meter of air. So a cubic meter of air, you took a box of air. In that air, how much pollen is in it? Going out from the suburban into the rural, you only have about 2,294. So the elevated levels in the city create more pollen in the city. We can also see, looking back at time, so they've been measuring pollen in the air for a very long time. And so with this global increase in atmospheric CO2, which is the orange bars, they've also seen a concurrent increase in the amount of ragweed pollen in this air going forward in time. So there's correlations between CO2 and the amount of pollen that's being measured in the air. So with carbon dioxide, we also have warmer temperatures, right? Because it's trapping the heat. We're running out of time. So we have longer growing seasons. We have changes in the timing of the allergy season, so longer starting earlier. And we have invasions of new species. And so Europe did not have ragweed previously. So this is current projections of ragweed that are now found in Europe. It's considered an invasive species in Europe. These are the same climate models that Julia introduced. So we have a best case scenario and a worst case scenario. So the higher emissions is if we keep going on as business as usual, which looks like we're heading in that direction these days. This is if we were to start using more renewable energy and cut down on our emissions. So either way, you're going to see expansion of ragweed in Europe. And so they're having much worsening allergies in Europe. The other thing we're seeing, so this is United States. So over here you have Texas all the way up to Canada. And so we're seeing an extension of the ragweed season. So in Texas, we're not seeing much. But when we get up to Canada, we see plus 26 days in our ragweed season. What could be going on that we're seeing an increase in the ragweed season in Canada, but not in Texas? What's the difference between Canada and Texas?
Cold temperature.
Cold, right? So Canada has season, and so we're actually reducing the number of days with frost by having a longer growing season. Whereas in Texas, you can't really reduce very much days that have frost, and so we're actually seeing worsening allergy symptoms the farther north you go with seasons, because we're decreasing the amount of cold days. So us living up here in the northeastern United States, it does not fare well for us.
No.
We can also go back in time, and so ragweed loves disturbed areas, so we can go back and look at land cover changes. And so this is data that was taken from a pollen core in the bottom of a lake in Petersham, Massachusetts. This was done by Harvard scientists. And so they can look in the pollen core and they can see high levels of charcoal, which shows that there was a forest fire that burnt everything down and allowed a disturbance to happen, and so ragweed came in. And so in the pollen core, we see lots of this charcoal indication of forest fire. We also see a large increase in ragweed pollen during that time. So we can go back and see that as land has changed, ragweed would come in and move in, and then it would get shaded out by trees again. So looking at allergenic species and climate change, so ragweed is the one that's been most studied because it's the most allergenic species. They found, just looking at one population of ragweed, they found a 61% increase in pollen output per flower within ragweed. So each of those little tiny flowers on the spikes put out 61% more pollen. We can also see an increase in allergenicity with rising CO2. So then the protein that coats the pollen, we're seeing more of that protein on each of the pollen. So not only are we seeing more pollen, but we're seeing pollen that's much more potent to us when we inhale it. We're also seeing an increased reproductive output. So with any plant, you have plants that are bigger and outshade, and you have little plants that are subordinate. And so what's happening with the CO2 is the big plants are already kind of maxed out, but the little plants take advantage of the extra CO2, and so they grow as big as the big plants, and so you actually have more reproductive output from these small plants, and so you're seeing an increase in pollen that way too. And then as I already pointed out, we're seeing an increase in temperatures, which lengthen the pollen season, and we're seeing longer pollen production occurring each year. People have also looked at white birch, paper birch, and so they're seeing a 260% increase in the male flowers on birch trees. So birch trees is a highly allergenic tree in the springtime, and so if you have more male flowers, you're producing more pollen, worsening allergy symptoms. So then onto the plant that I looked at grasses. So to date, no one's really looked at grasses before. Unfortunately, grasses are found all over the world. Ragweed's not found all over the world. Birch trees aren't found all over the world, but grasses are. And so I wanted to look at how climate change would affect grasses. So looking worldwide, about 20% of the general population has grass allergy, and about 40% of individuals that are already sensitive to something else also have grass pollen allergies. I have a repeated slide here. So I wanted to ask, how do CO2 and ozone interact to affect pollen production in grasses? And so I did this in these fancy little chambers inside a greenhouse at UMass. And so we're able to inject any kind of atmosphere that we want into these chambers through these little inlets here. There's little paddles at the top that stir the air, and so then we create these artificial atmospheres with whatever we want to expose these plants to. And so I raised both ozone and carbon dioxide. And so then to collect the pollen, I put plant condoms on, right? Reflecting the male human flight. So I put these plastic bags over the grass flowers, and so when they're released, you can see the pollen is dropping down and being collected in the bottom of the grass, the bag. Then I counted the pollen grains under a microscope. So this is a hemocytometer, and so it has a little grid on it. And so you mix all this pollen up into a known volume of liquid, and then you count 0.1 microliters at a time, and then you extrapolate to the known volume, and you're able to predict how much pollen is in there, which is, you know, 1 billion grains usually. So there's a lot of pollen that's produced by these flowers. And then I also... So this is my graduate work, and that's unfortunately, as a graduate student, you have to suffer through it. Now I have my graduates do my work. And so then we did what's called an ELISA. So basically you use IgE from a rabbit or whatnot, and you are able to connect it that has a dye to it. And so the more allergen that is in a pollen grain, the darker the color gets. And then you put this into a machine that's able to really record the very small differences in color. And that way we're able to see if the pollen is becoming more full of protein or not. And so this is what I found out from that. So I found out that per flower, we're expected to see a 50% increase with elevated CO2 per flower in the amount of pollen. I found out that ozone had no impact on the amount of pollen being produced. However, we also found that there was more flowers flowering on these plants. And so when you multiply the increase in pollen production per flower by the number of increase in the amount of flowers, we actually end up seeing a 200% increase in pollen with elevated CO2. And so you can see, so this black line is with no ozone, or background levels of ozone, and high levels of CO2 going up, and this is with high levels of ozone. And so even though it's about 165% with ozone involved, that's not significantly different statistically. And so then I also looked at the protein content of the pollen, right? And so we found that ozone actually destroyed the proteins. It damaged it. And so we saw a decrease in the amount of protein coating each pollen with higher levels of ozone. And so without ozone, we saw 190% increase in the amount of allergens that we're going to be exposed to. With ozone, we only saw a 47% increase. And so it kind of reduced the amount of allergen we're going to be exposed to. However, that's not good news, because air pollution actually interacts with pollen. So if you're outside and you get irritated by inhaling air pollution, and then you inhale pollen, you're actually going to have a more severe reaction to the pollen, because your mucous membranes are all irritated. So even though it's reducing the allergenicity of the pollen, it's still irritating our airways, and so it kind of equals itself out. And so then for my postdoc work at Harvard, I wanted to look at how, so previous work has only looked at one population of ragweed and how it responded to CO2. So we know, because ragweed is a natural varying weed that grows in the environment, depending on where it's grown, it could have very different genetics, very different life histories. And so we wanted to look at different populations distributed across the Northeast United States would respond differently to carbon dioxide. And so we went and collected populations from around New York City, from around Boston, and from around Burlington, Vermont. So we have both decreasing urban gradient and also a latitudinal gradient, which affects temperature and growing season length. And so we built these large greenhouses, and we grew plants inside of them. So we had three CO2 levels. We had four chambers per CO2 level. We collected from three different cities. We had eight populations that we collected at each city, and we replicated that four times in each greenhouse, which resulted in 1,152 plants that we had to count no flowers on. When this was done back in 2011, Laura was actually an undergraduate student that came and worked at Harvard Forest for the summer, so she was responsible for counting quite a few of these flowers. And that's her right there. So this is what we found out. So we found out that plants from the more northern population flowered earlier and longer than populations found near Massachusetts or New York. We found that elevated CO2 increased the length of all the populations, the time that they flowered, and also caused them to flower earlier, but this is more magnified in the Vermont populations, the more northern populations. And so this resulted in earlier and longer pollen seasons at all latitudes, with Vermont being even worse. So the take-home message is that if you're in northern, especially in northeastern United States, the more farther north you are going forward into the future, you're going to have more exposure to pollen than you would, say, if you lived in New York City. And so we looked at this, we looked at the number of male inflorescences, so the number of those spikes that were growing. We looked at height. The reason height is important because with wind-borne plants, the higher up you are, the better you get your pollen distributed. And then we looked at the number of branches. And so branching is also important. If you have lots of branches that are catching the wind, you're gonna blow the pollen off. And so what we found was that in Vermont, when you increased the amount of CO2, it actually put all that into male flowers, and so it increased the number of male flowers that it was producing, whereas in New York City, it actually put that into vegetative growth. And so the increased stimulation from CO2 was going towards just leaf growth in New York, whereas in Vermont, it was going towards flowers, which means more pollen being produced. And so basically the take-home message is expect to see increased exposure to allergenic pollen in the future, particularly if you live in northern areas of the United States where we have seasons and colder temperatures. And as pollen becomes more abundant and more potent, there can be new sensitivities. So some of you who don't have allergies right now could possibly have allergies in the future. And also as a result of having these species expand their ranges due to changing habitat, like Julia talked about a little bit, these plants are going to move into new areas and could have new people being exposed and affected. And so in terms of human health and climate change, this has some wide range effects on our health. So, does anyone have any questions? Oh. Sorry, it's a little fast in the end there.
Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
So, red maple wins at climate change. The rest of us lose.
I'm sorry, I know you're done and already clapped and everything. Why did the colder areas, you would think Vermont to be a healthy place than New York City?
So, it has to do with plant biology. So, the plants that are in Vermont are used to a smaller growing season. And so, they come up and they immediately put the resources to flowering because they want to flower before the season is over. And so because they're predisposed to putting energy towards flowers, when you add CO2, the resources, they're sending right to the flowers as opposed to New York knows it has a much longer growing season. And so it's going to expand its leaf tissue, the photosynthetic capabilities to then send up disease later.
But that would change over time. I mean, that's a genetic difference in these different populations.
Yes, so that's something
you know, over time.
Over time, we're going to see differences, yeah.
Right.
So,
looking on the right side.
Right, so these are populations that we just went collected and exposed, so we're not seeing that kind of genetic drift that it happens with generations of being exposed to the same thing over and over again.
Thanks very much.
Yeah.